Hello and welcome to C++ Weekly. I'm your host, Jason Turner. In this episode, I'm going to cover the top four places that I know of where you should never use const. And we're going to do this in like a countdown kind of way, starting with number four and working our way up to number one. Be sure to check out the video description for links to my ebooks, printed books, Patreon, and GitHub sponsor page, as well as news about upcoming events that you might be interested in. All right, so I'm starting us here with this very simple tool that will just tell us how many times an object has been copied or moved or whatever, because we're going to need this in a few places. We're also going to mix in some examples that have standard string because it is a very non-trivial but commonly used object, and we're going to use that to illustrate some things. So number four is on a non-reference return type. This will make sense in a moment. Okay, so I just have this very simple code that returns a value, hello long string. And I'm going to create another string. I'm going to call it S because S is a very useful name. And I'm going to assign these values here. S is going to be assigned to the value of make string. And we're going to occasionally just look to see like what kind of code did the compiler generate for us here. And we can see that we've got this make value function is taking up the first 17 instructions or whatever. So we're going to mark this in line just to prevent the compiler from emitting it into the object file so it doesn't get in the way of our looking at what main is doing. So this is what main is doing. This is 76 statements. Now, if you have read my C++ best practices book or watched any of my conference talks or taken any of my classes in a company, then you know that this is already a bad practice. This is a code smell for sure here. And it comes down to the fact, ironically, given the subject matter of this video, that S is not const, but let's just say we had a reason to create code like this. And we can see how much code is generated here. We're gonna go 76 instructions. Okay, so I'm going to mark this return value from make value as const. And we should expect to see a change here. We're currently at 76 instructions, and I'm just going to mark this const. And we have gone from 76 to 107 instructions. What has happened? We just accidentally, implicitly broke move operations. So we've gone from move assignment to copy assignment. Before I make a point of illustrating exactly what is happening, I do want to point out that your preference should always be code like this instead, where I just construct the value with the value that I want it to be. And we can see simply here that the code drastically reduces because we no longer have a default construction and an assignment. We are now constructing the value S with the result from make value. And this could also be expressed the same way. This is exactly the same code. We're going to get the same code generated again. And then what I said earlier about how then this encourages me to use const, because I say, well, this value doesn't have any reason to change for the lifetime of it, but we're not following best practices and we accidentally find ourselves in this situation, or we have some other reason to do an actual assignment operation. This const is breaking things. So let's go ahead and instead move it to an object of type S. And let's enable execution of the binary. Okay, so here we have the default constructed S, that's the one on line 22. And then we have the next default constructed s. That's the one on line 16. And then we have this copy assignment operator that's occurring here. And then we have two destructors called. The first destructor is the one that was the temporary returned from make value, and the second destructor is this one from little s. I strongly recommend that you check out my Object Lifetime Puzzlers book, which the entire point of it is having a better understanding of object lifetime in C++. But getting back to our example, this is where we have this copy assignment. If I remove this const from here, then I am going to get the expected move assignment. And to bring it all the way back around, if I create the object like this, I have exactly one object created because return value optimization, copy elision come into play, and I'll have just a single s constructed and destroyed. So this is not an actual assignment. Number four. Don't const non-reference return types in your function declarations. Now, number three is a little bit more nuanced. So we have exactly one S object that has been created. It is this one here that was created on line 23. Now, if you watched my episode on how member functions work, you would understand that this one on line 29, the little s, was the one that was created. A pointer was passed forward to it into makeValue3, where the object was constructed in place, and then the return statement doesn't actually do anything here. This is the key core of how return value optimization works in C++'s calling conventions. So this statement, again, technically true, completely meaningless. Now, if I add an optional s, and I'm going to change this to be auto down here. Now I'm relying on automatic moves. So now that warning from cling tidy actually matters. And we can see that this has become a copy construction here. So now when the warning from cling tidy matters, the warning actually goes away. So it's effectively a completely useless warning. If I remove the const here though, then I'm going to see that I get a default construction, a move construction, and two destructors. The reason this code behaves as it does is annoying to me, but it comes down to the fact that standard optional of type S has an implicit conversion from object of type S to object of type standard optional of S. So this local object has to be copied or moved in some way into the optional so that it can then be returned. Most people don't appreciate that standard optional is not a pointer type, it is a value type, and it contains an object that must be somehow constructed, copied, or moved into it of some sort. Now we can do this, where I'm actually constructing the thing directly in place in the optional, but that's its own episode. I did an episode previously on how to use in place T. So I'm going to get these back to the bad versions so that we can have this correct for the sake of the episode. So there's slightly more to this story. And that is the case where you are doing something relatively normal, but return value optimization cannot come into play. Okay, so S is returned, we're getting return value optimization. Okay, so in this case, the compiler was unable to figure out which of these objects it should apply return value optimization. So we've got a copy here. We don't get return value optimization, and the clang tidy warning makes some sense. And by making this not const, I now get the moo. Now, you probably know that there is a best practice that says to limit the scope of variables as much as possible. I believe this is even in the C++ core guidelines, and I believe mentioned in Beautiful C++ as well. And we see that we still don't get return value optimization here because we've got two different paths through the code. And if I were to make either one of these const, now I'm going to have this copy come into play again. So the out here is to do something like this, where we know that return value optimization is guaranteed by C++ 17. So let's just take this back to okay, so that covers three of the four. I am creating this object in place. This is not essential to understanding what's happened here, but this object on line 42 has been constructed in place with the statement on line 50. That is the default constructed S. The copy constructed S comes here on line 44. And we get an actual meaningful warning from clang tidy here. It says, warning, constness of S prevents automatic move. So if I make this no longer const, then we will see a move operation occur. So there we go. We have an automatic move of the object S on our function call parameter on line 44, and that becomes this object on line 50. That's better. So the rule is don't const non-trivial value parameters that you might need to return directly from the function. That's quite the mouthful, but that's the situation that we have here. Again, this is very nuanced of a detail. The likelihood that you want to take a const value non-trivial parameter is low. You might be doing this in the case of multi-threaded or re-entrancy, or in some case where you need to make sure that you have your own copy of the object, but you don't intend to mutate it. Generally speaking, this other warning that we get, that this parameter is const qualified and it's going to be copied for each invocation, is true. We probably want to do take this thing by const reference. Now we're going to be back in the situation still of getting a copy back. That's because we're explicitly clear that what we want is a copy in this situation. So very nuanced, very nuanced. Okay, that's number two. Now we need to get to number one. And this is the use case that I see most often people doing. This is a very straightforward example. I have this object data, and it's got a single object of type S, and it is printing the default constructor and the destructor. Now, this might be obvious, it might not be, but I can't assign to little d. And that's not surprising because this has a const object in it. What is perhaps slightly more surprising is if I do this, I'm probably not going to get a warning from the compiler in any way, but I'm actually getting a copy here, not a move. There's no indication from any compiler warning or static analysis tool that what I thought was a move is actually a copy. And this becomes a problem when we start to use our data structures with const members in standard containers. Okay, so I'm just gonna again take kind of a hand wavy look here, and we say we were pushing back two of these string data things into my vector. I've generated 385 units of work, shall we say. To call them instructions is not quite right because they're function calls and all kinds of things. If I remove the const here from the string, then that drops to 242. So approximately dropped by a third. And that's because we accidentally broke the ability to efficiently resize our vector. So if I put back in here my object of type data, then I can see that I've got default construction of one object of type S, default construction of a second object. Those are the two being emplaced back. When the second one is emplaced back, it has to copy an object into a new memory location, and then I get three destructors called. And if this is not const, then it should be default constructor, move constructor, and then three destructors. This is all the kind of thing that you learn if you have me out to your company to teach one of my object lifetime classes, which I find is enlightening to literally every single C++ programmer that I have taught it to. So don't const any member data. Now, of course, the question that you're going to ask me is, well, what if I've got an invariant in my code and I need this data to be const, otherwise mutating it causes other problems, then you simply might need to write some accessor functions. So those are the top four places in C++ where you don't want to use const: as member data, as a value parameter that you might return, as a object that you might return when there are multiple possible objects that you could return. That's a subset of three here. When we are just relying on implicit moves is a bad place to use const. And number four is you never want to const non-reference return types. I will make sure that there is a link to these examples in the video description. And I hope you enjoyed this episode of C++ Weekly and you learned something new, and that you hire me out to your company to have some on-site training, and that you check out my Object Lifetime Puzzlers books. Thanks for watching.